Hello, everyone. Hopefully you had a great break. We're back again for the second portion of this exciting store app refresh with HTML5 and Windows 8 app development.
Woohoo!
And we're going to be considering yet another exciting topic with regard to some of the deltas and differences. And let's go ahead and take a look at our theme here, multimedia and devices. And so we're going to start moving forward with these three topics, and this is going to launch us right here, and then we'll get into some package and deployment to be followed lastly by tools and asynchronous programming. That's the final module. But right now we're going to discuss multimedia.
Not just single media, multimedia.
Yeah, exactly, the multi stuff. And let's go right into the first content and talk about some of these things. Some of these are, again, just maybe FYI, just good for you to know. And for those out there, and I'll even pause for a moment just to say, even before I get to any of these, that for those that are watching and you're exploring what the video updates are going to be, some of you may have extensive experience in this area, and some of you may have hardly ever incorporated audio or video before. So the endeavor here is to bring a balance and to say, let's provide you with what's up, as well as let's also provide those who have extensive experience. They're probably going to see some things and go, finally, it's about time. I'm so grateful. So let's go ahead and dive in now and consider first that for those that are interested in playback, the Common File Format, the CFF, is now supported for MP4. Also, there's a new, it's called Transcode Video Processor, XDP, and the mode that's been released by the media powers-to-be is MRF-CRF-444. And what's that mean to you? Well, what it should mean is that you'll understand that this is a very unique processing because every single bit of it happens purely in software. And the reason for this is so that it can be consistent with results across all the different platforms. Yet, because it's all entirely in software, that means it takes zero advantage of any of the hardware acceleration that could exist on each respective platform. So there's your advantage and your disadvantage all in one. You know, it works everywhere, but not as great as it could if it was targeting the platform. But that mode is supported, and if you wanted to take advantage of that mode in your app, then you would specify that mode in code. Also, there is a new generic type of media source called the Media Stream Source, or MSS for short. And the reason why we have this, you could kind of think of it almost as a layer of abstraction for the media, and that is you can extend the platform support and allow for different future even media formats and adaptive streaming. And you'll be seeing an example indirectly of that in one of the demos I'll be doing soon. By the way, for the tech guy, you said to tell you about the time. Okay, and then as far as the video capture updates, now what's kind of interesting is what's on the screen right now, this thumbnail support and the many new photo and video modes. Well, there are so many video capture updates, it's insane. It's almost too much to, it was too much to fit everywhere. That link that we provided before, and if you didn't hear it, aka.ms/whatsnew81, and maybe Jeremy, if you get a chance, if you can make sure everyone has that in the current session, just in case people are joining us later, he'll provide that link in the chat room. But that's the link where you can find out all the different modes. Like there's torch mode for the LED support that your device might have, and a lot of different effects and things that can really treat your device more like that multimedia device. So you'll want to take a look at that. Having said that, I would like to get into a demo. It's a media capture demo. And I'm going to move into Visual Studio. And I think what would be effective to do is I'll go ahead and launch this application right now, and I'm going to run it on my screen. We'll see some of it, and then I'll just show you a couple of the highlights in the project itself. So on my screen right now, this is the media capture using JavaScript. And it says it demonstrates how to use the Media Capture API. Now, to do a variety of things, so let's find out what. I'm going to start the device. It started. And if I wanted to start a preview, I could. Hey, everybody, this is what it looks like for me. I could even start to record. Another example of recording, stop record. And you can see it down here. And I can also take a photo. What? No, let me take another one. OK, very good. So I have this going on the thing here. And I didn't like the angle, so I switched it. And boy, this works out really nice for the tech guys. I can have my video right here as we're talking. OK, now I want to show you something else that's very cool that you could take advantage of. Going through and capturing the various devices. So I will start. Oh, that's right. This is one of the reasons why I wanted to highlight this. In fact, even better, let me just go ahead and go to this last one, photo sequence, and I'll explain why I said it was so much better. Let me just skip over there. It's actually waiting for a moment because I clicked on the one to enumerate everything, and so it's taking a little while to check what's on my machine. But while it's doing that, I just wanted to explain. Where I'm going is also to explain an important factor with all of this, and that is when you're starting to use the multimedia and when you're really wanting to hone in and say, hey, what's this device capable of? Don't make assumptions that in your app that all these new features are available on a specific device, because some of it's going to be based on what the device actually has. So again, don't make assumptions. You'll have to do some checks in your code. And that's what I'm waiting for right now is, in fact, what I might do just to simplify this, keep the camera on me because I'm just going to get out of that one particular app. I think I'll start it up again and just go straight to that one area so we don't have to wait so long. So, okay, let's go back to my screen. I'm at photo sequence. Now, photo sequence is one of these new features that I think is great. And what it basically does is, have you ever wanted to have the webcam take continuous pictures, but you're not necessarily interested in video, you just want continuous pictures? The first thing I would think of is possibly like a security context, right? That could be one. But there's a variety of reasons why you'd want this. But for that photo sequence, you would only be able to do that if the device supports this particular feature that's built in. So let's start the device, prepare the photo sequence. I'm going to do this here. And look at this. It says right here, photo sequence not supported. It just highlights that my device doesn't have the latest and greatest and whatever camera stuff. So I won't be able to do that demo. But in a sense, my demo is the demo that you still need to check and make sure you didn't assume anything. So I'm going to go ahead and stop the project right there. And I'll show you what it would look like if I were to open up the photo sequence, for example. Going into, let's see, I think it was the capture. Right. Sorry, I lost my spot. Looking for where I had, there it is, right there. So the supported feature, I just wanted you to see how simple it was. It was much simpler to probably type that line than it was for me to find it, but that lets me know if the photo sequence was supported or not. So a lot of the features have that kind of easy check for you to do so that you can see if something is supported or not on the device. And of course, what I would recommend, and the name of this particular one is the Media Capture project. So if you wanted to dabble on that, see what your device supports, and also look at the code, you should definitely download this particular sample project. OK, so the next thing that I want to get into is a very interesting topic. And as you can see on the screen, we're talking about playback updates. And there's support for the encrypted media extensions, EME, so that you would be able to play through your app DRM stuff without the use of any plugins. Also, the same thing with media source extensions, MSE, so that you can make dynamic changes. This is one of the things that you do, is enable changes to your media stream, again, without plugins. Because that really was what we needed to do before, especially in the web world. We always had to think plugins if we wanted to do anything kind of rich with our media experience. So with that brief explanations stated about these two things and playback updates, I'm just curious if Mr. Foster, if you have any comments on those particular items.
Oh, boy, do I. So this looks kind of dry. Two new three-letter acronyms introduced having to do with media. What does it exactly mean? Mm-hmm. But what these are actually the underlying wiring of technology that I've been waiting for a few years since I heard about the fact that they were working on it, and that's called MPEG-DASH. MPEG-DASH is HTTP streaming according to the HTML, the HTTP standards, according to the W3C standards.
Cool.
And so it's really super exciting. You know, Microsoft has its own HTTP-based streaming technology. We call it Smooth Stream. Mm-hmm. And Apple has their own, HSL, and Adobe has their own. And they're all good technologies, but none of them are the standard in the web space until MPEG-DASH. And MPEG-DASH is a consorted effort by a number of companies, and we always love that, don't we? We always love it when there's something that's more of a standard. So what I want to do is I actually want to show you some of the exciting things around MPEG-DASH and what it's capable of doing. So first of all, I won't show you this part. I'll just mention it. Have you heard of a little competition that goes on every 2 or 4 years called the Olympics?
Yes.
And it's pretty big. I think most people have heard of the Olympics. The Olympics, the Olympics were in Salt Lake City, I believe it was. I hope I'm not misspeaking there. Microsoft was responsible for the streaming of the Olympics live online. It was done in Silverlight. It was done with smooth streaming. And mm-hmm. there were a lot of media capabilities that had to be in place for that. And so we were ramping up a lot of software for it. And all of that effort went into a product that we call Azure Media Services. Hmm. And Azure Media Services has got a lot of recent improvements. It's really, really cool, really exciting. And one of the things that Azure Media Services is capable of doing is serving MPEG-DASH.
What?
Yeah. So you can actually serve that format. So you can upload a video, transcode it, encode it in whatever formats you want, and then you can serve that. You can publish that video as an MPEG-DASH service. And that means that it's going to be able to dynamically use the technologies that you just mentioned to serve that video, okay? So that's
very cool.
You can go sign up for a trial of Azure, and you'll get, I think it's 30 days of a quite generous usage of Azure, and so you can check out cool. Azure Media Services there. And then even if you end up using it, I think the cost of Azure Media Services is quite reasonable. So keep that in mind. And what I want to do is I want to take you to a website right now. So let's switch to my screen. And on this website, I'm going to go to, in this browser, I'm going to go to IE Test Drive. There are all kinds of exciting things at IE Test Drive because this is the playing field of all the latest web standards, okay? You could spend a lot of time in here. So we've got some that kind of act as a bit of a benchmark, like this light bright one. Check this out. Okay, so that's Light Bright, and if you're as old as I am, you know exactly where that music comes from. You know exactly what Light Bright is. Light Bright is acting here as a benchmark for a lot of web standards. If you look down at the bottom, it doesn't appear that it's showing right now, but if you, it should show on your browser. It'll show you that this is testing the CSS 3D transforms, the hardware acceleration of those. And I don't even remember all the technologies, all the web technologies that this is going to show off. It's a lot of different stuff that it tests. Mm-hmm. And I hit run benchmark, and it takes X amount of time to build up this logo.
Right.
And if you look at this in some of the competitive browsers, you're going to see that it's really super fast in Internet Explorer. Because of, this is completely unrelated to the media standards, by the way.
Okay.
But there is a standard called Set Immediate that allows us to make an excellent compromise between battery life and performance. Whereas Actually, it's the lack of a compromise. Before, we had to make a big compromise.
I see.
In order to get decent battery life, we had to really slow things down a lot. And set immediate means that we don't have to do that anymore. So check that demo out for sure.
That's cool.
And actually, the lawn mark demo is real similar. This one just looks like the grass is growing. And when you start it, the grass grows in the shape of various browser logos.
Yay! Tech guys are making comments in the back.
Yeah. And so that's using the same exact advantage. It has demos like Glacier Works, which is actually in partnership with another company. And this is showing off the fact that IE11 has WebGL built into it, which is awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a completely WebGL demo that allows us to kind of zoom into various parts of Mount Everest. So that's great.
Wow.
What else do we have in here that we can show off? There's a ton. But there are two demos that I really want to show. Oh, there's one I want to show off. Watch this. This is in the browser.
Okay.
This is because Internet Explorer, as well as Windows Store apps that are created using HTML and JavaScript, which uses the same engine, but Internet Explorer is capable of differentiating between the various types of touch. It's capable of differentiating between the various fingers that you're using while you're touching. It's got a really good pointer model. In fact, we submitted it to the standards body, and in the latest version of Google's Chrome Canary, it's being implemented as we speak. So
Pretty
exciting. Anyway, what this is doing, it's taking some time to load a number of really high-res photos. And then this is going to give me a touch interface where I can grab these photos and I can drag them out on the screen here.
Okay.
And watch, I wonder if we could just get a little bit unconventional here. Michael, could you scoot over so I could borrow some hands?
Yes.
And let's see how many of these pictures we can get moving at the same time. I think I'm capable.
Do you want me to start moving some?
Do you have
around?
Two hands?
Oh, wow. Yes, I do.
There you go. And now see if you can get, look at this.
Okay. I'm trying.
We're working with all of these pictures at the same time. My screen here is capable of, then see, it's ignoring these touches because we've got too many, but it's capable of 10-point multi-touch, or maybe that picture is just frozen. Oh, that one is pinned somehow.
Okay.
Yeah, anyway, so all of this is happening through the browser. It's happening because IE recognizes this pointer model. So super exciting demo there. Try that one in the competing browsers. But the demos that I really want to show you that do have to do with what Michael was talking about, the MSE and ECE, the standards for media playback, are these. Does everybody recognize Netflix? Have you heard of Netflix?
Yeah.
In the world? Netflix is pretty popular. Let's go ahead and open this up. Now, when you open Netflix in the website and you want to watch a movie, what kind of technology do you suppose it uses to play that video?
Something magical. Something.
It's not magic. I'll tell you, companies have a number of options, right? They could use Flash. You'd be crazy anymore to try that. You could use Silverlight. We're kind of moving away from that. You could use a variety of techniques for actually playing that video local, but you're going to have something installed on the client, right? Unless you're using HTML. Unless you're using just the standard video tag.
Right.
Well, if you're using the video tag in most of the browsers that are out now, until what we're talking about now, you can't play video through the video tag and do so in a secure way.
Right.
And uphold the DRM so that, you know, not just anybody can go play that video, right? So here's Netflix. This is actually just in partnership with Netflix. They've offered this demo. It's a trailer of the show that plays here in the States, at least, called House of Cards. And I can play this demo. Here's the important thing. This is playing without any plugin installed whatsoever.
No plugin.
No Silverlight, no Flash, no ActiveX object being installed. This is playing.
It's all about location, location, location.
Exactly.
The closer you are to the source, the higher your property value.
Isn't this cool? We are now at an age where everything can happen through these HTML standards. So super, super awesome. I'm really excited about that.
That is awesome.
Let's go ahead and pause House of Cards. Let's hit back. And let me show you another demo on IE Test Drive. This one made to really show off the flexibility of the ECE standard, the one that you mentioned, the ability to switch around the feed. So let's open Big Buck Bunny. Now, if you haven't watched Big Buck Bunny, I highly encourage you to watch it all the way to the end.
Okay. I've never seen it all the way to the end.
No, you haven't? Mm. I won't show it online. No, it's. I don't think it's appropriate. I don't know what the rating is.
Oh, okay.
So.
Yikes.
Yeah. Anyway. I have been showing this video for a little while, and I've only ever seen the first 10 seconds, and then the other day I watched the whole thing for who knows what reason. Anyway.
But the reason why it became popular is because I believe this was used quite a bit to demonstrate some, when HTML5 was emerging, this was one of those videos that kind of popped out a lot, and people were using this to say, okay, this is how it looks.
That's right. And now it's hosted here in this IE test drive that's showing off the use of MPEG-Dash. Now, MPEG-Dash is the standard that wraps these standards that you're talking about, and you can go implement a Dash client using JavaScript, but there's a popular one that already exists. It's called Dash.js, and you can actually go use that client online. I forgot the exact URL, but just search for Dash.js, and you'll find that. And what we have here is this MPEG-Dash being served directly to the browser. We're going to go ahead and watch Big Buck Bunny, and notice that the bottom of underneath the video frame that you see the video bit rate, and it's adjustable. And it's currently set to 688 kbps, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's the current video bit rate. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open Fiddler. And if you're not familiar with Fiddler, it's going to intercept all of the HTTP on the client as it goes. It's going to be intercepting all the HTTP traffic and showing it to us so we can see what's going on. It's very handy. As a web developer, this type of tool you should definitely be tuned into. Okay, so right now it's got a filter installed, and I actually want to turn off that filter because I've got it filtered to the right thing here. It's only going to look for this one server, right. And that's what I want it to look for. So I'm going to go ahead and start playing Big Buck Bunny.
Now, what plugin was using this?
Thanks for asking. There's no plugin. Now, what I want to do is I want to switch over to Fiddler, and I want to show you the packets that are traveling across the wire. You can see that there's video and audio traveling across the wire, and these are basically in approximately 3-second clips.
Okay.
Okay? And it's dynamically pulling these down. And the thing I want to alert you to is the size of these packets. This is a video packet.
Yeah.
And it's about 196K, right?
Okay.
The audio packets are about 60K. So
gotcha.
That's the size of things currently.
Okay.
Okay?
Very
those
nice.
Are coming in. Now, while Big Buck Bunny is playing, let me just go ahead and zoom in on it. And that's going to pause it. Let me go ahead and dynamically zoom in on it.
Okay.
And you're going to be able to see the quality inherent in the feed here, okay?
I gotcha.
Now let me go dynamically turn that down.
Okay.
And while it's still playing, look, we've got live motion, and you'll see it click down to low quality. Did you see that? And now let's flip over to Fiddler, and let's look at the size of these packets now. Whoops. The size of these packets has now changed.
What?
They are closer to 88K.
That's brilliant.
So this is less bandwidth, and it switched dynamically live on the fly, all that goodness.
Wow.
Now let me go back to Big Buck Bunny. Still playing. You can see our quality is quite low. And now I'm going to up the quality, just max it out. We're going to dim the lights in Redmond here.
All right.
It should take effect within about 4 seconds.
Okay.
Bam,
whoa.
There it is. Great resolution now. We're at the highest resolution.
Good.
Our bandwidth is perfectly capable of it. It looks good, and it switched on the fly. So we've got a continuous spectrum of bandwidth options here, and MPEG-Dash is going to dynamically deliver those for us. And now look at the size. What it's done to the size of these video packets is just delivering larger packets.
Wow.
Isn't that impressive? So that's MPEG-Dash. You should get excited about MPEG-Dash because it's a emerging standard that has all kinds of possibilities.
That was very
cool. And you should be excited about Big Buck Bunny, but not quite as excited.
Yeah. No, you know what? I love that you highlighted that because really it's kind of like a really nice visual way to explain what all of these kind of cool features do.
Yeah.
I like that.
Netflix would not have been able to serve that video with DRM if it weren't for these standards. The whole thing was implemented in JavaScript. You could implement it yourself. It's not, the hardest thing in the world, but it's kind of already done for you using -js. So.
Cool. Well, if we could go ahead and switch over to my screen, I have the media playback sample here. And I'm also going to showcase some things. Jeremy showed us some of those technologies straight through the web browser. We're going to also see some examples of how to do some items right here from our app. And again, the idea here is playback through the simple video tag. No, we're not talking about plugins, just the simple video tag.
I love it that everything's happening through the video tag now.
I do too.
Can you imagine? Remember my demo about the video in the app bar? You could have Netflix.
Oh yeah.
Streaming into your app bar.
Right.
Netflix streaming into your app bar.
I hear ya. Sounds like an app. Okay. Let's
just
see.
Just saying.
I like this one. This one showcases some things that we can do here with the audio. So I'm going to play this video. And again, this is all through the standard tags and some of the things that we can do with the API now. So I will turn up my volume big time.
这是频道三.
I need English.
This is channel one.
Polish.
To jest kanał czwarty. To jest kanał czwarty.
Hindi.
Ye dusra channel hai. Ye dusra channel hai. Ye dusra channel hai.
So there was a continuous playing of that audio. We actually chose this multi-track approach to demonstrate that you can have the video going and swap out your audio on the fly, which is what we just did. Check out this Zoom one. Ready? And we're playing. Let me zoom in. Look at the right side over here.
Woo!
Zoom out.
We care
zoom
about
in.
Windows users. And Windows users.
Quite exciting.
Over half.
This is the one that really caught my attention, though. I really like this. I'm going to play this, and I'm going to just dynamically turn on and turn off subtitle rendering. Again, simple video tag. Play. So we'll wait till he starts talking.
My name is Jason Weber, and my job is to make
turn off.
Fast. We care about Windows
turn
users.
On.
And Windows users.
This is all done without a plugin. Yeah, yeah. I would show you the stereo 3D, but my device doesn't support it. I feel like I need a new device. I don't know. But anyway, I'll go ahead and shut that down. So we got a little bit of excitement there, just seeing at the different ways or levels that we can engage with some media playback, and I'm excited about that. And I want to now talk about another thing that we can play to, and that is play to updates. Now, play to the feature, when it came out, this is allowing us to go ahead and play our video or audio or whatever we can stream or even a photo from our device onto another device that supports. Now, this is another example. We had some people asking these questions before, and I have it explicitly in this particular slide. You are now recommended to programmatically launch the Play to UI. Now, I'm wondering if Jeremy remembers what we would have had to have done in the past if we weren't going to programmatically do it. Do you have any clue?
Yeah. I do. The user had to initiate it, right?
Yeah, and it was crazy because at least I felt it was crazy. I had to, you know, I'm wearing the Microsoft hat, and I'm like, rah, rah, yeah, let's use those charms. But it may not have been intuitive for some users to just know if I have this video and I want to play it to something else, where would I go do that? So that's why that's on that slide, is because it's saying, hey, you need to adhere to a new UI guideline that says you do need to launch that UI programmatically, and it recommends an in-app button using the Play to glyph, which there is one. Now, the other thing that is available with the Play to is if you provide a reference, you can play DRM protected content and check it out again straight from the video tag itself. You just apply that attribute and you can go ahead and enable the playing of that DRM content, which is pretty cool. Okay, well, that's going to take us off the multimedia discussion for a moment, and now we're going to start to talk about devices. So in addition to the fact that we've had these various levels of things that we can support with multimedia, we now have a variety of different devices that also can come into the mix that are new. Again, new ways that we can interact with devices with 8.1. Wasn't that you couldn't before, it's just that there's some new or updated options. So let's take a look at our first one here, and that is the Human Interface Device, or HID support. Now, for starters, this is under the Windows Devices Human Interface Device namespace, or in that section. This API has two distinct audiences: hardware partners and developers who are interested in targeting a specific device that implements this API. Now, the reason why I'm stressing that it has these two distinct audiences, and it kind of sets the theme also for some of the other things that we're going to be discussing anyway, and that is these are starting to get pretty vertical. In other words, we're starting to get to an area where it might not be the needs of all apps, it probably would be the need of very few apps or very targeted apps. And there's a lot of rules that go behind some of these device interactions. So if you are a hardware partner and you have a device and you want it to be accessible through apps, then you would need to, of course, understand that the HID standard, which you would. But now you might be struggling to see, well, how would apps interact with it? And then the vice versa is the developers creating an app that want to access the device, but they might not be up and, you know, hip on the level support. So this is how I thought I would approach the devices section. And that is, if you are interested in this, you definitely need to go and look at the documentation on this, because once we get down to this level, it's going to start to get to be a little bit of a dry read for the masses, but probably an exciting read for you. So that is one level support. You know, these devices that we're talking about right here, initially targeted like your keyboards and your mice and so forth, and then it expanded out to other devices through this standard. So, I was thinking of one from a hackathon about a year or so ago, where someone just wished that the kind of camera that he had that support. And I think that's what's kind of cool when I was reading up on this, is thinking consumers will start to demand that even more. They'll want to have that standard implemented, and the hardware partners know that. So as we move forward, of course, every device will have a different reason why you're interacting with it. So, of course, you'll have to consult with the device documentation as well. Well, let's look at another area where devices would be used, and that would be in the area of POS, or point of service device support. And so if you're interested in that, that's going to be at, and it's on the screen, here we go, the windows.devices.pointofservice. Now, in this current release, what that means is that the support is there through the API, but it only supports in 8.1, at this time, barcode scanners and magnetic strip readers. This is another example, however, of even though there's samples for it at the MSDN, unless you have those items, and I don't have a barcode scanner or a magnetic strip reader, then it's really not going to matter much to you. But if you have that, then you should engage with those samples that are there. And then with regard to more device support, there's additional support now for USB. And specifically on the USB, it's really saying, it's kind of saying we're providing a model, a kind of a generic USB driver. For devices that didn't necessarily register something specific. So that's the kind of support there. There's also Bluetooth, and it's kind of a drum roll, but a 3D printer.
Woohoo!
Now, I saw this for my first time. In fact, we're both wearing our little hoodies that we got from Build.
We did. We were mentors at a hackathon at Build, and they gave us, all of us were wearing the same shirt so they could tell who the mentors were.
That's right.
And how many 3D printers were in the room?
Oh my goodness! I thought there was three or four. I mean, or
more than that, there was at least six.
It was amazing. So if you haven't seen 3D printing, you know, I kept hearing about 3D printers and I never saw them before. And when I saw them, I'm like, "Holy cow! They
print 3D.
They print objects." I'm thinking this elaborate like 3D paper that might, you know, no, these are objects.
Things.
They're things. You hold them. You can use them.
On the campus at Microsoft, we have a project called the Garage. You'll see projects come out of the garage where employees get together and work on things. It's pretty cool. And in the garage, they have a 3D printer that is 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter.
Wow.
It can print things up to a cube.
That's crazy.
Cubic meter.
Yeah, because the ones I saw, we saw maybe, you know, about this big or so. I mean, they weren't that big. But, you know, an example, one of the things, in fact, the winner of the hackathon at Build actually won by merit of their project that was targeting a 3D printer. And one of the persons on that team had created a site where, you know how people with musical instruments, they want to have a mouthpiece that's just right for their mouth. Well, the 3D printer would actually let them create that mouthpiece in the software that would just be perfect for their mouth and then just print it up and here you go. And it sounded great. I'm thinking, this is pretty cool. Well, that support now for 3D printing is part of the 8.1 experience.
And it's the only operating system in the known universe that's able to print natively to 3D.
Yeah. Okay, well, that brings us to the summary for this module. Very concise. We talked about the multimedia playbacks and the new features there. We got a little education I keep wanting to call it something else. My synaptic connections are messed up.
What are we talking about?
The one that you showcased. I want to say something, and I know I'm going to say it wrong. The
MPEG dash.
Thank you. I want to call it dash.
You were really close.
I was so close. And then, of course, the devices. With regard to the devices, you really need to have one, and you really need to download the samples and dig into it and probably have the interest in that particular vertical market. So that is going to wrap up this section. I know that the next module is going to be very interesting and crucial. If you ever want to make a dime, you have to go through this next module, so to speak, in
there
a way.
You go. Yeah.
So stay tuned. We'll see you after the break.